Welcome back to the Lisa Weston Show, where we explore pathways to good health, transformation, psychological interventions. How do you turn your defeats into victories? How do you turn those scars into stars? That's what we're about here. And we also are very interested in social justice, responsibility, medical care, and developments. And today we have a special treat with Nancy Burns. Nancy is the EMC, Medical Reserve Coordinator and EMT. Thanks. Nancy, thank you for joining us today.
Thanks for the invitation. And I know the name is a mouthful.
I know, we rehearsed this and I'm still addicted. Well, emergency medical technician is like a training. Mm-hmm. And then the medical reserve coordinator is what we're about today. We're going, you know, often on my show we talk about micro matters, like how to turn your anxiety around and how to let go of emotions, and we just talk about flushing feelings, whatever. Today we're talking about the macro level, like when an emergency hits a town, mm-hmm. when an emergency hits a community. And Peter, can we show slide number two? When there's an emergency like this, when there's a hurricane, a tornado, a flood, a terrible storm, or God forbid even worse, biological problems in the water or something. Let's see slide number two, no, slide number three rather. We all matter. I love this because you matter, I matter, and all of us are together in this journey towards wholeness and a happy life. Mm-hmm. And that's what the Medical Reserve Corps is here to help us through those tough times when things get really wacky. So Nancy, tell us about this new program that's starting, Until Help Arrives. You're very excited. It's the first.
It absolutely
toot the
is.
Horn.
The reason is the program is brand new from the federal government. It's coordinated by four agencies, so to get them all to agree is pretty amazing anyway. Mm-hmm. Our National Medical Reserve Corps unit, which covers like 1,000 units across the country, 200,000 volunteers based in D.C., they're collaborating with three other agencies to make sure that people know about this. It's been in the works for a while. It was called Active Bystander. It includes a module similar to a program that came out in October called Stop the Bleed, mm-hmm. and that's specific to first responders. So they've pulled together all this information for the general public. Mm-hmm. That's why they call it Until Help Arrives. It's brand new. It was just announced in April. Our unit just got a grant to carry it out, so we're very excited.
The first one, like the first one.
We're the first classes in Massachusetts. We had mm-hmm. our pilot class 2 weeks ago. Mm-hmm. We've got the first one for the public tomorrow. Mm-hmm. And it's so important. I don't know if you've heard of Amanda Ripley. She was a writer for Time magazine, mm-hmm. still is, I believe. She wrote a book called The Unthinkable. They talk about disasters that you mentioned and you were showing slides about. Mm-hmm. And it focuses on everyday people, the general public. Mm-hmm. They're the ones that save the lives. Mm-hmm. In that 10 minutes before the cavalry comes, the police, fire, EMS, a lot can happen.
Mm-hmm. It's critical.
Yeah. Right. We talked about normalcy bias and when mm-hmm. people are first confronted with a scene and they're not trained first responders, they want everything to be back the way it was and normal, and it's disjointed. And so what we're doing is trying to encourage people some steps to take if they are confronted with a disaster mm-hmm. and how to help.
Well, thank you for that. And what's interesting is the website has some wonderful videos. There's a short one that's like 25 minutes. Mm-hmm. Then there's an interactive video where you can press options. And like, how many times have you maybe seen somebody laying in an accident, maybe at a ballpark or something, and you don't want to hurt them? You're afraid if you do something, you might damage them. And been there, done that. I mean, I've been in Central Park where a guy was lying on the floor, and I wasn't sure what to do. So I asked him, I had water with me. He said, do you want some water? I didn't know what to do. This was like mm-hmm. years ago. But and there's also an instructor-led training. But that's more 3 hours. And check the website. Can we see the website for the UMVMRC? That's going to be the place you go. Thank you. That's going to be the place you go for signing up for the three-hour training. It's a free training.
That's correct.
And it'll help you feel more comfortable and relax, knowing that you know the best possible things to do during an emergency. Mm-hmm. So that's what you want to be able to do. And I'm definitely going to take it on my next free Thursday or Tuesday, whatever, Tuesday evening. Now what I want to do is break down the five steps. The You Are the Help, Until Help Arrives video talks about these five steps, five actions to take when there's an emergency. So we're going to go through all five now, even though mm-hmm. they do a whole workshop on this with dummies and blood and whatever to learn.
So no blood in the demos,
no blood,
just so you know.
No, just not even flake blood?
Not even fake blood, no.
Okay, so let's start with number one. Step number one, call 911 and provide specific location. Anything you want to add to
that? Sure. I mean, all of these are covered in each of the pieces. The interactive video is basically for kids, and apparently 9 and 10-year-old Cub Scouts think it's a blast, and they want to go take it again and do the other answers. The web-based training is the 25-minute video for adults, and then the 3-hour classroom class, they all cover the same points, but in the more detail.
Yes.
After you've realized there's something here that's not quite right, I really need to notify somebody, right away call 911. That may sound obvious, but a lot of people assume somebody else did it.
Right, just do
it. I know
it.
Medical people that have been in the scene helping, and then they said, well, didn't you call 911? Oop,
no. Right. So all of us just call 911, even if you think somebody else may have, doesn't matter if there's redundancy.
Right.
Okay, next. Okay, so we call 911, and we have the specific location, just the address. Now, what if you don't know where you are? Mm-hmm. The phones have GPS. The phones actually have compasses on them. There's actually longitudinal information.
A lot of them do. One of the parts that we cover in the 3-hour class isn't just dial the number. They are used to talking to people who are scared to death and not medical. But when you watch the video, take the class, you'll see different scenarios, and they ask you what you're aware of. And then when you call 911, you'd be able to say, I see this, I see that, this is the location, I don't know the street, but it is a highway, and I see a McDonald's at the corner. Okay. So they can discern where you are, how bad it is, whether to send one ambulance, two cruisers, a medevac helicopter.
Okay.
So those are all parts of calling 911.
That's good enough. And there's a compass on your phones, but TMI. Okay, number two, stay safe by protecting the injured from harm and moving them away from any ongoing danger. So tell us about that.
If, for example, you're at the scene of a fire, which happens a lot, it's one of the most important things. An apartment fire. Red Cross gets called more for that than anything else.
Really?
If the building is burning, if it's falling to you, you could get the person under their arms and drag them out of harm's way if you need to. And if there's people around, work with them. So you could all help, maybe put a blanket under them and pull them out of the way safely. You can try to keep them stable.
That's a great idea.
Or if it's in an earthquake and the structure's unsafe, you want to get them out of there, out of harm's way.
Out of harm's way, and like in the video, they're in an amusement park, and like the rides are crashing down on hit. Things are falling apart. Like it's a worst case scenario at the amusement park. I was watching this video, laughing, thinking, oh my god, it's amazing parents even bring their kids these things anymore. You know. All right, so number three, stop the bleeding with firm direct pressure or a tourniquet.
Absolutely.
Tell us more about that.
This is one of the reasons we don't have fake blood. I personally worry about the E factor. You know, you don't want to be thinking in those terms. This could be somebody you love, so you try to get people to push through it.
So what about this t-shirt business? They said in the video, take a t-shirt and like tell us about
Ideally, you can have some kind of barrier device. We do provide gloves. We encourage people to have something like that. But if all you have is what's on you, you could just take an old t-shirt or someone else's coat or something or a jacket and press it over the wound. You want to make sure that if the wound is here, you want to keep it up higher from it because blood goes out that way.
Okay.
So you would apply firm, direct pressure and no peeking. Keep your hand on it.
Just keep the hand firm. So maybe we should have some clean rags in the car at all times, or clean old t-shirts.
That wouldn't be a bad thing.
As
having a couple of bandages would be even better, which we have in the class.
My husband, God bless him, is big on this. He just bought this safety kit from Costco that has like 20 kinds of Band-Aids and antiseptic and all this wrapping stuff, you know.
Yeah.
All right, so we got that. So the third thing is stopping the bleeding with firm pressure and the blood flows down, so keep it high up. Okay,
right.
Great.
At least 2 inches closer to the body than the
inches closer.
Right.
Okay. And number four, position the injured. Let someone who is conscious position themselves. Put an unconscious person into the recovery position. Now, what is this about? Tell us about this.
There's two separate positions, and one of them is if a person is conscious, they're having trouble breathing. By nature, they tend to be in a tripod position. They lean forward. It's easier for them to breathe that way, and they support themselves. If they find that's their position of comfort, let them. You don't want to force them to lie down or in a backboard or anything like that.
So if they
that.
Feel better sitting up.
If they feel better sitting
let them
up.
Sit up.
Yeah, because if somebody is also having trouble with phlegm coming up or secretions or whatever, they might feel less nauseous, better able to breathe when they're sitting up tripoding. If they're unconscious, especially if they're lying on their back, there might be stuff gurgling in there that you don't want them to aspirate.
Oh, yeah.
That's one of the reasons we turn them on their side. EMTs like me call it left lateral recumbent. We prefer to have you lying on your side, so if there's any secretions, they'll fall out this way. There's nothing interfering with your breath.
Left lateral.
Right. And if you can't get them on their left side because there's an injury or something bad, roll them on the other side, but you don't want them leaning in the back. So that's another thing about it.
That's fascinating. What about, I'm sure I don't watch a lot of those medical emergency shows, like with the dead bodies being pulled away. I forget the name of that show.
There's enough of those out there.
But I've seen enough, even in science fiction shows, where somebody can't breathe and they take a pen and
That's a myth. Tracheotomy.
Do you do tracheotomies? Is that part of this training? Is that part of the 3-hour training?
Oh, heavens no. Okay. We don't do surgery.
I'm ignorant. You don't do that. Well, so you've seen people who can't breathe and they stick a pen in their neck and like suddenly they're breathing. It's like, what the heck? And there's no blood coming out?
The best thing is the position. I mean, that's why we say on their side you can open their airway. That's another big thing you can do too.
How do you do that? Open the airway?
It's not really covered in the class. We do hands only CPR, but basically there's a technique for just stabilizing the head. Like if they're slumped over, push it up so they can breathe, because otherwise their tongue may be interfering with their throat.
Right. What about sticks? Do you put a stick in there?
That's old school. That's when they talked about epilepsy. When I first became an EMT, they used to do bite sticks. Now they're verboten.
They're gone? Okay.
Yeah, they're so gone.
I'm just so ignorant.
They have airways.
Okay, so this is positioning, and the recovery position is on the left side, lateral?
Yeah, preferably on the left side, but it's not all
that
important.
Doesn't have to be if they're injured. Okay, and what
if
about...
If they're unconscious especially.
What about feet elevated? I know sometimes when someone is feeling dizzy or weak, if you put the feet up...
That's more the province of a first aid class, and that's very valid. And I actually did that in a road race. I was running, a guy fainted in front of me. I lifted his feet. They used to say, faces pale, raise the tail. Faces red, raise the head.
Oh, I like that.
Isn't that great?
Say it again, faces...
Yeah, faces pale, raise the tail, meaning lift the feet so the blood goes, more oxygenated blood to the brain.
Okay, that makes sense.
And faces red, raise the head. That's if you're... One of the things we encourage in the class is what other training you might want to get, and by all means, a first aid class would be great.
I see. That's interesting. All right, so we have covered that, and now number 5, providing comfort to the injured while keeping them warm and offering... encouragement. Now that's an important, tell us about that.
And it's good that beforehand you were mentioned, having watched the video, the importance of just holding somebody's hand, that tactile, you're being friendly, you're being very present
and
with
soothing,
them.
Soothing, saying, it's going to be okay, help's on the way, just relax, keep breathing.
To tell them, I'm with you, I'm going to stay with you until help arrives, we've called for an ambulance, what else can I do to help? They may say, oh, there's this stick digging into my back and you could maybe move it out of the way, or I'm cold, put on a coat, or if it's hot outside, maybe find a moist cloth and sponge them off a little bit with it. But keep them warm, but if it's 90 degrees outside and that's why they collapsed, or if they just came out of a fire, you might modify that.
All right. I imagine at the end of marathons, there's a lot of emergency stuff going on because people push themselves.
Absolutely.
What about if someone's diabetic? What is the protocol when someone's diabetic?
That's outside the province of this class.
Outside of this? Okay.
There's a lot you certainly can do. And that's another advantage for non-medical people taking this. You see somebody who's not well. They're just not acting right.
They're shaky.
Altered mental status, maybe. They're not, we used to say talking smack. They're just not making sense. You might tell that to the ambulance. An EMT would be trained in doing things like checking their blood glucose level, but you certainly want to make sure they have an open airway and that they know help is coming. So those are great things to do, and note what the signs are to 911.
I know, one of the benefits of working in a hospital, I used to work in a hospital outpatient, and in my office, I'm not over 10 years in New York at Mount Sinai, I'm not exaggerating, epileptic seizure.
Right.
Somebody had a diabetic low blood sugar thing, and they started frothing, and I thought they were having a seizure, but they just had low blood sugar. And one woman had advanced Alzheimer's, and she jumped across the desk and tried to attack me. Like, things happened in that office, but I had a panic button under my desk, and
good.
I could press the button, and in 30 seconds, the security guard was in my office, and help was on the way, like the 30 seconds.
Absolutely.
In private practice in Westford, it's a concern sometimes, like if something happens, like, I know Emerson's down the road, but I'm going to take this class because there's things that happen that I don't know exactly what to do. I'd call 911, that's for sure.
Well, truthfully, the reason I became an EMT was my first job, being 16 in a nursing home not far from here, a woman fell and I didn't have a clue what to do. And that's why I said I don't ever want that sickening feeling. That's the whole point of this, until help arrives. Normal people like you and me would know what to do. And when you see things in the news that are just so tragic, you don't want to feel helpless and wring your hands. This is something positive anybody can do. So that's why we're promoting Until Help Arrives.
What is the age range of people who come to Until Help Arrives? Is there a limit? Like, how young can they be?
Great question, Lisa. Basically, we encourage people 18 and older to take it. children from 13 to 18 can with adults. Just some of the visuals are a little bit upsetting, so we want to make sure they're with a parent. Even still, kids do very well with this.
It's good to learn when you're young.
Especially
absolutely. Things happen in playgrounds, things happen in school with the bullying. You've got to, you know,
yeah, and with your next door neighbor who had an argument with his lawnmower.
Right. We've seen it.
Yeah.
So this class is available. Apparently, there's one in Nashville. You said every month,
right.
And Westford has one. It'll be on the website posted.
Absolutely.
So you can call Nancy to find out the details. Now, mm-hmm. It's funny because before we did the show, I wanted to do a show on pet safety and emergency preparedness for pets, but this was more urgent and timely. But we might have a few minutes to talk a little bit about the pets as well, because I think we've covered the salient topics.
Mm-hmm.
Before we go forward, I want to just ask, can we see the picture of the volunteers on slide number 5? I want to show, I have a picture of the volunteers, Pete, there they are. So there's your 30 or so volunteers from the website.
Sure.
And these are some, and you can be in this, you can be part of this group too. Anybody who wants to volunteer, I'm sure there's room for more.
Absolutely.
And what's nice is that, I always say in my practice, that if you feel useful, and peaceful. It's the foundation for a great life. And mm-hmm. I think being part of the Medical Reserve Corps, you really are being useful. I mean, this is an important task. And the more people who are useful, you feel that sense of camaraderie and connectedness mm-hmm. and community, and it's very powerful.
Well,
it's very healing.
Well, the wonderful thing about the Medical mm-hmm. Reserve Corps, we have 550 members. Right now we're pursuing until help arrives because it's life-saving. But we've done all sorts of things. Like you mentioned, we had a grant for pet preparedness.
Mm-hmm.
So each of our 7 towns has equipment that if they had to set up an emergency shelter, people have to have a place to put their pets. You should never leave them at home. So they have equipment and some training to do that in each of our 7 towns. We've also done flu clinics, and we've responded for emergency shelters when there's been power outages and snowstorms. So do check the website, the umvmrc.org, and that tells you all the things that we've done. And I'm due to update the website just for the last 6 months, but we've been so busy.
You're very busy. Now tell me, there are 550 members in Westford?
That's no, 550 members in our unit, and that covers our 7 towns.
And what are the 7 towns?
Billerica, Chelmsford, Dracut, Lowell, Tewksbury, Tewksboro, and Westford. Right. I've had to practice it a lot since 2004 when we actually hired and got members.
I saw it on the website, but I saw that you cover quite a territory from Billerica to Tewksbury.
It's over 250,000 people that live in the area.
So if there's a terrible ice storm or blizzard or something, you're the guys that help give the blankets and the food in the high school cafeteria.
We have both medical and non-medical people, mm-hmm. and the nice thing is you can't work in a vacuum, as you know, Lisa. We integrate with other first responders, police, fire, EMS.
Right. I noticed FEMA is also part. Is FEMA?
Well, FEMA is a different federal agency, so mm-hmm. they're sort of a counterpart in a way. But the nice thing about a Medical Reserve Corps unit is it's local. Mm-hmm. About a third of our members are nurses, another third other backgrounds,
really?
And maybe about a third are non-medical. And that's true nationally as well. We need non-medical mm-hmm. people just as much.
Well, I know. I remember I had my brief experience with the emergency situation on September 11th in New York.
Oh, yes.
I was actually a graduate student. I changed careers in 2000. I was in my graduate school program, and they asked all clinical social workers, whether you're licensed or students, to get down to the river, because
mm-hmm.
there were hundreds of people who were having grief and crazy stuff happening and numbing out and disoriented, whatever. And I remember a professor saying to us, well, you're getting hands-on training for emergency trauma, and like the trauma thing. And I was younger, I mean, I wasn't that young, but I remember thinking, like, I cannot believe this is happening in New York City, because when you went down Riverside Drive, there were all these tables with the booths, you have those
mm-hmm.
And therapist booths. They had us 4 therapists per booth, and we were sitting there. I was a grad student.
It's like Charlie Brown,
Lucy who has the... And it said therapy. They made up a sign that said therapy, and I sat there, and people were just coming over and like pouring out their hearts.
Oh.
And then I had to fill out an intake form for them. And we were sitting next to the Red Cross, and there were several groups working, but like there were 10 of our booths from social workers and therapists. Psychologists, psychiatrists, social workers, we were all sitting together, and the sign over the tent said therapy.
Oh my gosh.
I know. It's funny. I never took a picture of it. It didn't even occur to me. It was so freaked out. But
that was the catalyst, by the way, for the whole Medical Reserve Corps.
September 11th?
Yeah, because people rushed to the scene wanting to help and basically getting in the way, weren't identified. So someone decided, let's find a way for volunteers to help. So that's why we exist. So you don't want to just show up.
No.
You want to show up with They know who I am. I've got a uniform. I've got a badge. I've got an ID. I've been couriered.
Yeah, they gave us these name tag things. But the Red Cross seems to be mobilizing everyone. I think the school went through the Red Cross to organize the therapy booths. I don't know. The dean handled it. I don't know. It was thinking back on it, it's kind of a blur. But that was my first exposure for like hands-on trauma work, you know. And then, you know, it was an opportunity to learn also. They gave us these extra courses on grief and grief counseling. On the spot, grief counseling with total strangers. Like, who does this? You know, usually they come to your office, you know, this is like a whole new thing. But it was, we all did it.
9/11 was a point off the curve. That was a catalyst for forming some of these organizations.
Yeah, so it was wonderful. And they mobilized, not just Hunter, my college was Hunter College School of Social Work, you know, Columbia, Fordham, NYU, Wurzweiler, all of us were there. And they had rotations 24 hours a day. Wow. And they had us signing up for a morning, evening, and night over a two-week period. So we were all signing up. It was like, and we just did it. Everyone just did it. But anyway, it was beautifully done. And I hate to admit this, but you see the best part of humanity.
Right.
Tell us about that. When there's an emergency, what happens to humans?
People really want to help. I mean, I'm sure that you heard stories about, like, the Boston Marathon, that people weren't trained.
Yes.
The guy in the cowboy hat went, pinched off a nerve, saved a life. He wasn't medical. But other people, I mean, even the thing in England not too long ago, the bombing there, that people would text, please, if you need a place to stay, come to my house.
Right.
Other people going
so
over
generous.
Trying to comfort them.
I love the generosity. Well, speaking of volunteering, let's see the slide number 8, please. Can we see slide number 8 now? Volunteering, this is obviously no pressure, but we'd like you to think about becoming a Medical Corps volunteer, which means taking one of these classes and just being part of the pool of people that are available when things happen. You know, we all want to be useful when things happen, because there's plenty of people who will not want to get involved for whatever reason, you know. Mm-hmm. And one more time, let's see the contact information for Nancy. Slide number 6, please. That has everything on it. There you go.
Great.
So it's Nancy and her phone number in Westford. They're right on Main Street. Aren't you on Main Street?
The town hall is in Main
Street.
Hall. That's where the office is. My office is down the street.
Down the road from there.
But
okay,
the name is too long. It's the Upper Merrimack Valley Medical Reserve Corps.
No, it's perfect. So they have your phone number and website. And it's been great having you on the show. Thank you so much. We will come back in the fall and do a show on the pets and pet emergency, which, dear to my heart, are the animals. I mean, I care about people, obviously, but we'll come back with the pet show. So this was great. And this has been the Lisa Wesson Show. And can we have slide number 9, please, to show the final contact information? Thank you. So I'm also available for consultation on DBT, and what I started doing something new called walking and talking therapy. So this information, that's my contact information. And the best times to reach me are usually from 11 a.m. to 7 p.m. if you want to give me a call at that number. And so that's it for today. Is there anything you want to finish with? I think we have a minute.
I very much appreciate you inviting me. The Medical Reserve Corps offers a lot of diverse opportunity for everybody. And if they just call, they can find out how to join. We don't place a lot of demands on people, like monthly meetings. We don't believe in them. You can be as active as you want to be, or just do a few things periodically. But we train everybody so we can use them how they want to be used.
Excellent. Okay, thank you, Nancy.